We'll discuss creating blocks next. A FlexiLayout block corresponds to an area on an image from which data is to be captured, that is to say, OCR'd by FlexiCapture. Blocks indicate the type of data possibly located in the specified area. We'll get to that a little bit later. And it also specifies the specific area coordinates. Now that can be dynamic, form by form, because fields can land in different areas. We're dealing with semi-structured forms here. So blocks are commonly referred to as future FlexiCapture fields. Those are the fields that are going to be verified and the fields that are going to be exported. Since we plan to extract the full name, address, and account number fields, we'll need to create the corresponding blocks for those fields, and I'll do that right now. So I'll right-click in the block tree branch, and we'll click on text block, and we'll name this full name. We can't have spaces. I'll click OK, and let's also add a block registration address using an underscore there. And account number. So there really are several block types available. We've got text for textual data, a table for table data, barcodes for barcode data, check marks for individual check marks captured on the layout, check mark groups for groups of check marks, pictures for non-textual objects, a non-recognized block for, it's essentially an exclusion area where we don't want to capture any data. And also we have groups for a logical block grouping or field grouping. And finally, a repeating group block, which allows for blocks with repeating instances. Now let's create ID elements, which are unique objects identifying the document type. They can be any string or strings that occur only on page one, for example, document name or company name. So in the search element tree in the header group, we'll create new elements of the static text type and we'll make those elements required. So we'll create two required elements to identify this document type. I'll go to the header group, I'll right click, I'll add an element of the static text type, and I will name it bank name. And I'll set this from the default of optional to required, and then I want to use the string alphabet beta bank, and I can just copy it by clicking the L. I can right click here and copy that recognized text. I could just type it, but I prefer to paste it. And there it is. And I'll create a second ID element of the static text type again, and I'll call this account statement, and I'll call that keyword account statement because it's a keyword, and the actual text I'll look for is account statement, and we don't need to include spaces, and I need to go back and make this required. And those are our identification elements. An element describes one or more image objects, such as separators, which are horizontal or vertical lines, static text, pictures, etc. An element contains information about the type of the object, its geometrical features, its likely location, and relationships with other objects. The program uses the properties of an element to look for the object it describes and determines a region for the object. A region is made up of one or more rectangles enclosing the object. The program uses the detected objects to locate blocks. Let's add new elements to the header group to capture the full name field. It's not an identifier, but should be found in the first page of the document. So organizationally, we're putting it in the header. I'll speak to that in a moment. So we're going to first add an element of the static text type, and we'll call that keyword full name. And the actual text string that we'll look for is again full name. And we'll also look for an element of the character string type called full name. And since it's not a keyword, we're not going to put the KW prefix in there. So from an organizational perspective, everything on the first page is in this header group. These two items are required, so they're identifiers. These two items are not identifiers. So it's pretty typical for me to put those maybe in a group outside of the header because FlexiCapture software opens the header and it looks for identifiers when it's trying to match a bunch of different document definitions. So I like to keep my headers with those kinds of elements, just required elements only, but it is possible to put non-required elements in the header, and you can see that I can move objects around. Next, I'm going to do a very quick test on the header. I'll right-click, and I'll select Match, or Control-E, and we can see that the header is being found, let's see, on page 1, on page 4, and on page 7. So since we're dealing with multi-page documents, the program needs to identify both the beginning and the end of the documents. The header and footer groups are used to detect the beginning and the ends of the document, respectively. We already have a header, so now let's create a footer. So it looks to me like the last pages are pages 3, 6, and 8. And if I look at page 3, I see a specialist signature. On page 6, I see the same. If I check 5, I don't see that signature. And 8, once again, I see that signature. So I am going to create a static text element in the footer. I'm going to call this keyword signature. And I am going to place this string as my search text. And I'll go back and make this required. When you have a required element, you see a little green check mark. Now I'll match my document again. And we'll see what our results are. So we can use this area to see what FlexiLayout Studio found. Found a three-page document, a three-page document, and a two-page document. There's one more step that we need to take. We brought in single-page images instead of a three-page document, and a two-page document. So I just need to assemble this to a reference document for these pages. And when I do that, I'm essentially telling the software where I think the first and last pages are. So I'll do that for the second document. And lastly, I will do that for the third document. Assemble to reference document. And when I do that, we see the red is gone, and we see that the blue bars are matching the green bars. So FlexiLayout Studio allows debugging in this manner. You can compare the actual results with how we think the results should look. The blue bars are what we predict should happen, and the green bars are what actually happened. Once you've created all the needed elements, you define the block locations. This is typically called mapping the blocks. So if I look at the full name block here, right click, click on properties, we see a source element. We're going to map that in a second. We also have an expression. This is utilizing FlexiLayout language to maybe make a dynamic mapping or defining of the block area. We also have this has repeating instance checkbox, and that's for items that have repeating instances. And then for those items, you can specify the instance sort order, top to bottom, or in order of finding. So we will go ahead and map this source element not to the keyword full name, but rather our character string full name. And this is just a demonstration. So we did not put relations in for the full name so that it would look relative to the keyword full name. So this isn't working as we expect it to later on, but we're just showing you how to actually map a block. And when we map the block, there's a small empty square in the upper right-hand corner of the block that goes away.